Divine Truth Frequently Asked Question Session. Jesus, Mary and others provide answers to questions that are frequently asked by members of the media and public. This presentation is part of the Cults and Cult Leaders series. Mary asked Jesus questions on the subject of cults, religious practices and beliefs. Recorded on the 13th of November 2012 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is Session 1, Part 1.
On Wikipedia, under cult religious practice, it states in the first few lines, in traditional usage, the cult of a religion, quite apart from its sacred writings, scriptures, its theology or myths, or the personal faith of its believers, is the totality of external religious practice and its observance, the neglect of which is the definition of impiety. Cult, in this primary sense, is literally the care owed to the god and the shrine.
Mm.
Do you feel that care is owed to God?
Well, firstly, if I point out that the word cult comes from the Latin cultus, and which actually literally means care. So the suggestion is that that all religions need to care for the way in which they worship God, and if they don't care for it, they don't have enough piety, and therefore, you know, that they are not properly observing that particular religion. So it's interesting the underlying word that the word cult comes from is implying that God needs to be cared for. And the reality is that God does not need to be cared for. God is self-caring and self-responsible, and God does not need to be cared for, and God isn't seeking our worship. There is this common viewpoint on the planet, I feel, that God is seeking worship, and God does not seek worship. God knows herself very well and knows her value, and she doesn't need us to support her value or to make her feel better about herself than she already feels. And in fact, the underlying word of cult is implying that. Now, if you look at how the word is used today, word is often applied to a cult leader, of which I'm often associated with being one. And if you look at the underlying thing, again, it's like, does a person, one single person, need to be cared for and honoured above all others? And the answer to that is also no. Any person who has any degree of self-responsibility and who's any degree of love for themselves does not need to be cared for by any other person, and so therefore does not need to be worshipped and does not need to be even listened to. God doesn't have an investment in us listening to God, and any person who is an appropriate spiritual leader would also not have any investment in another person listening to them. Yeah. By appropriate spiritual leader, I mean a spiritual leader who is not invested in other people's opinion of them and who is just interested in telling the truth.
Yeah. Do you feel that God punishes those who neglect worship of God?
Definitely not. In fact, God does not even desire our worship. God desires our love, which is a very different thing than desiring to be worshipped. Desiring to be worshipped is somebody who feels a lack generally within themselves, and they want somebody else to support that lack by providing them with feelings that they wouldn't otherwise have. God doesn't do that with us. All God desires is a relationship with us, and God desires that we have this relationship in a sincere, frank, open, truthful manner. God certainly does not desire our worship in the sense of desire all of these reverential emotions given to God. However, many people who come to know God do finish up giving those particular emotions to God because of the honour they feel towards God. And that is a different matter of whether God desires it or whether the person desires to give it. God desires a close relationship with each one of her children, very similar to the type of relationship that a parent desires with its children on earth. And so it's very important for us to understand that God doesn't demand that we worship God, but rather God desires a relationship with us based on love. So I don't believe God demands worship, and therefore God does not want to punish the people who do not worship God. And this whole concept that the people who do not worship God will be punished comes from a very human trait of punishing people who do not give honour. God is okay with the concept of giving us free will, and that means that God is also accepting of the fact that we may not honour God or we may not worship God. God still makes the sun shine upon the righteous and the wicked and makes it rain upon the righteous and the wicked, because God is not selective in the way in which God gives her gifts to all of her children. However, God recognises that there are some children who will receive God's gifts differently and who will desire to have the closer personal relationship with God. And under those circumstances, more love flows to that particular person because of their desire for it.
Do you feel that external religious practice makes a person sacred?
Definitely not. In fact, what I have found in my personal experience is that many people who have an attitude of piety or an attitude of being holy are often some of the least holy or impious persons on the planet, because they use their piety as a justification for violence. What is true about religious practice is that there is only really one religious practice that is God's definition of a religious practice, and that is whenever we love. So whenever we act in a loving manner towards another person or towards another thing, we are automatically in a state of piety, if you like. We are not creating an alternate state based on belief systems, but rather we have a feeling and a desire to love. And it's this feeling and desire to love that is true religion.
Do you feel that neglecting religious practice is impiety or a lack of reverence for God?
No, I don't believe God ever established any religious practice. The fact is that almost all religious practices that I have observed on this planet have all been the result of a person or a group of people deciding upon a religious practice that was acceptable to God without asking God whether that particular practice was acceptable. The concept that God has a desire for a certain type of practice is, I feel, fraught with a lot of impossibilities and dangers. Whenever we establish a concept about God that is our own, we are automatically establishing a concept that is out of harmony with God's concept of himself. So the reality is that God does not demand that we worship God. God does not demand even reverence from us. However, God desires love, and love automatically does certain things when we are truly loving. We automatically desire to know the person, desire to understand the person, desire to understand their will and their long-term intentions. And all of these other things are a part of desire with regard to love. So I feel quite strongly that religious practices are fraught with dangers. And in fact, I don't want to establish any religious practice. However, there is possibly one practice, and I wouldn't actually call it a practice, but rather a desire that God is looking for from us. And that is this desire for God's love, the desire to have a relationship with God. If there's any practice at all, the singular practice that we need to be involved with is this desire for a relationship with God. In that desire, we will generate a desire for truth, a desire to be humble, but these will be desires and not forced upon us by our relationship with God, and they're certainly not going to be forced upon us by God herself. God has no interest in forcing us to do anything. And if we do not desire love and we do not desire humility, then of course God will allow us to make that choice.
Do you believe people should be rejected for not having the same beliefs?
Definitely not. No single person should ever be rejected under any circumstances, with the exception of perhaps one, and that is when they have harmed other people's will, they need to be shown that that particular desire to harm another person's will was out of harmony with love. Rather than rejecting them, they need to be demonstrated to them how that was out of harmony with love, and they need to be restricted from those particular practices. So many people in the human race now already do that. In terms of most governments do this. For example, when it comes to murder, most governments on the planet accept that murder is not the correct action to take towards another person. And whenever a person does take that action, they are generally restricted in some way, usually by being placed in a prison and so forth, and restricted from taking that action again, and hopefully until the time that they've recovered from the reason of why they wanted to take the action. Of course, unfortunately, on the planet, there's not much focus on recovering the person, but rather on punishing the person. God's focus, though, is on recovering the person. So with regard to ever there being an excommunication, if you like, of an individual from a religion, every time we excommunicate somebody from something, we no longer give them the opportunity to grow. What we need to do is always give them the opportunity to grow. And that is going to mean not excommunication, but rather addressing the issue that's out of harmony with love in the individual, and addressing that issue sometimes firmly if need be, but certainly not with any desire for punishment or violence. So every time a person is excommunicated from a religion, I believe that the religion itself is just demonstrating its own cult-like behavior. And there are many mainstream religions on this planet who do this, and this would indicate that many mainstream religions are cultish in their particular desires, because they wish to control the actions of the individual, even if the actions of the individual have still been loving, but not what they believe is pious. So I feel quite strongly that the important factor should be whether the individual is practicing love or not. If the individual is not practicing love, then certainly there needs to be some kind of restriction of their behavior. But we would never take those restrictive actions in a place of rejection or a place of rage or anger towards them, or a desire to punish them. What we would do is we'd desire to correct them by demonstrating love to them, but also demonstrating to them when they are out of harmony with love themselves.
Are you setting up a new religion?
Definitely not. I have no desire to set up a new religion. The main reason why I have no desire to set up a new religion is I believe that almost every religion that has ever been set up on this planet has been the ideas of men and how those men believe God wants to be worshipped. As I've already stated in other questions, I don't believe God needs our worship. God desires our love and a relationship with us. And for that reason, God does not need our worship. God does not need a religious practice in order to be validated. So I feel quite strongly that there is no need to set up another religion. What we have a need of is having every single organization on this planet come into more harmony with love. And that includes every single religious organization, because there are many religious organizations on this planet that are completely out of harmony with love and completely out of harmony with ethical behavior towards other people. And we need to bring each religion into harmony with love and into harmony with ethical behavior, the golden rule, if you like, that I taught in the first century. Unless we're willing to treat other people how we would like to be treated, it's really impossible for a religion to have any benefit at all. Now, a person can go on practicing their religious practices if they want to, but they must come to understand at some point that these practices have all been defined by other people, usually other men, sometimes other women. And these particular practices have no bearing on a person's relationship with God. So I feel quite strongly that we need to change this and start seeing that love is the thing that God is concerned about, not religious practice based around some kind of definition of humanity.
On Wikipedia, under cult disambiguation, it states in the first line, a cult references a group whose beliefs or practices are considered strange. Do you have any beliefs that are strange?
No, I don't believe I have any beliefs that are strange. However, many other people who have listened to some of my beliefs perhaps think they are strange. Mind you, I could probably say the same about their beliefs in many occasions. In fact, many of the beliefs that I observe in most religions, I believe, are quite strange. And so if that is the definition of a cult, then that would pretty much make every single religion and other organisations that are strange defined as a cult. I don't believe that if somebody is strange or different, they should be defined as someone who's a cult or part of a cult. Cults, to me, are very, very different organisations, and we'll talk, I think, more fully about that through answering other questions. But I can't see how a person who is different or a group of people who are different should be labelled. My feelings are that every single person on this planet, no matter what their background, cultural, sexual, political or otherwise, they should be honoured and loved. And I feel once we have that attitude towards all people, we won't be going around labelling different people as members of cults or not members of cults or members of religions and not members of religions, but rather we'll be labelling every person perhaps as a child of God who deserves my love.
Do you suggest any practices that are strange?
As I have said many times in my discussions with people and on the YouTube presentations, I do not believe that there is any practice at all that we need to engage in our worship of God, because I do not believe God desires our worship, but rather God desires our love and a relationship. I do feel that there are certain things that will help us with regard to that relationship. One of those things is a desire for God's love, which I view as prayer. Another one of those things is a desire for God's truth, which I also view as a prayer for truth. And then third thing that I view quite important is a desire for personal humility, something that we need to do to see ourselves more accurately. We need to be honest about ourselves. These are things that I believe are important in our relationship with God. I do not believe they can be practiced. They can either be desired and felt or not. They can't be something that we rotely go through some kind of intellectual practice and this earns us a place with God. God is more intelligent than that and also understands more about us than we do. If we believe that we can just go through a heap of intellectual practices while at the same time having unloving emotions, then we have a very poor opinion of God, in my opinion. If we believe that we can get away with having all of these terrible emotions coming out of us, all these unloving things that we do to other people, and then still believe that God is going to accept us, then we've got to relook at the whole situation. And we've got to see that God is far more intelligent and far more loving than a God who would accept that kind of worship. So I feel no religious practice is necessary to connect to God. I do feel that a desire and longing for God is necessary to connect to God. And that is going to involve three things: a desire for longing God, for God's love, desire for longing for God's truth, and personal humility, the ability to see myself as God sees me, and warts and all, and to be the person that I truly am, and to work on recovering the person if the person I truly am is out of harmony with love. These are the only things necessary for us to have any relationship with God. Anything else, any other religious observance, is a man-made creation that is completely unnecessary in our relationship with God.
On Wikipedia, under cult, it states in the first lines, "The word cult in current popular usage usually refers to a new religious movement or other group whose beliefs or practices are considered abnormal or bizarre. The word originally denoted a system of ritual practices." So, under this definition, almost any new group would be considered a cult. What would you say about that?
Well, that's correct. I feel, for a start, that what myself and Mary are setting up is not a new religious movement. It's certainly not new, because it's something that we set up 2,000 years ago anyway, and it's not a religious movement. in the sense that we're not interested in having worship or priests or any of those other things. We are interested only in a direct connection with God that every single member of humanity can engage. So we're not interested in setting up a new religious movement. However, people who know us do group together at times. So in other words, myself and Mary arrange a seminar and a whole group of people come along. Sometimes it's the same people who came along last time, although not always. And so my feelings are with regard to that, that every time we have a seminar, we're not setting up a new religious group. We're just presenting a series of information about what we have personally learned about God and relationship with God, the human soul, and many other important aspects. I feel, though, that under some of the definitions of cult that you can find in Wikipedia and dictionaries and elsewhere, almost any religion could be viewed as a cult. Now, my personal opinion is that the word nowadays has a connotation of evil to it, and we at some point need to discuss why it has such a connotation of evil to it. The reality, I feel, is that there is no need for us to keep labeling different things on the planet as having evil, not evil. We just need to see when something is out of harmony with love and bring it into harmony with love. And if every religion on the planet and every political organization on the planet and every medical organization on the planet and every other type of organization, company or otherwise on the planet, brought all of their practices into harmony with love, we would have a lovely environment in which to live and enjoy our life. And in particular, if the family brought their particular practices into complete harmony with love, we would just have a wonderful existence on this planet. The reality is, though, that we don't have a wonderful existence, and the reason why is the only problem we face is defining what love is. Whenever we set up different religious observances, we are not defining what love is, we are defining something different. And God is only interested in love, not in all of these other things that we're trying or attempting to define. God is certainly interested in truth as well, but not at the expense of love. So we must always focus on the fact that we need to be loving, and that is going to be the only, if there is a so-called religious practice, that would be the only religious practice we would be involved in. I believe that a lot of the definitions that we find about cult, you know, in the world today are all about people's fears being applied to certain groups of people, and they have nothing to do generally with reality, but rather the application of people's fear. Years and years ago, for example, the Catholic Church in the second century of this millennia was viewed as a cult, and the government was so afraid of it that it was attacked and bitterly persecuted for a long period of time until the government decided to make the church its state religion. And then all of a sudden it didn't become a cult anymore. All of the other religions that weren't the state religion became cults. And this is an illustration of how we manipulate the word in order to punish people who have a different belief from ourselves because we're afraid. And if we're truly loving, which is what God desires us to be, we would never imply these particular things and certainly never act violently towards another group of people, no matter what their belief.
Do you have a group of people that you organise in any way?
No. The only people that I actually organise are the people who help us set up a venue for a seminar and help us dismantle the venue for the seminar, and the people who actually help us with the distribution of divine truth on the planet. Now, there are many, many more people than that who come along to our seminars or come along to presentations or workshops that Mary runs or different interviews that we do, but we don't generally organize them. Generally, some other people may organize them, but what we do primarily is just rock up at any request from any person, depending on whether we want to or not, and then deliver the information we wish to deliver if it's desired to be heard, and then we leave. And then we have a group of people who then get that information and produce that information onto the internet so that other people can share in the information that was presented. That's the only things that we actually organize. We don't organize a religion. We don't have a hierarchy of any kind. We don't try to organize people to do things every week. We don't have a religious church service. We don't have a church at all, in fact. And we don't have any other things that most people believe we have from the media reports.
Do you have any beliefs or practices that are abnormal or bizarre?
I would say, again, that we don't have any beliefs or practices that are abnormal or bizarre. But again, it depends upon a person's definition of abnormal or bizarre. A lot of people on the planet believe that feeling an emotion is abnormal. And so if feeling an emotion is abnormal for you, then you will certainly believe that when we feel our emotion, that we are being abnormal. My feelings is that no, every single little child who enters this planet is able to feel its emotions perfectly. So that's normal. And then what we turn it into being is something abnormal. So I feel what is defined as normal or abnormal, bizarre or acceptable, it just almost completely depends upon what somebody has been brought up with over their life. Most people would suggest that getting a baby at a certain age and then cutting off its flesh around its penis, which is what happens at circumcision, is a pretty abnormal thing to do. But then there's other people who believe that it's a part of their life and has been a part of their life for thousands of years. And so they believe it's the normal thing to do. There are other practices such as getting a child who's only a few days old and sprinkling it with water and saying now that it's now baptized and therefore saved is a pretty abnormal practice. Whereas other people, in fact, over 1.5 billion people on this planet, generally practice that with every one of their children that they have. So I believe there are many practices that happen in religious practice that any other person observing could say that's pretty abnormal, but which the people involved feel is pretty normal because they've been brought up with that particular practice. We do not engage in any of those practices. However, we do feel our emotions like a child would, and we do have a desire for God that because that's a part of having a relationship with God. And we do examine ourselves a lot, like, because we're quite humble and we want to examine ourselves a lot. And if a person believes all of those practices are abnormal, then so be it. I don't believe they're abnormal. I think that's part of being what I would classify to be a good or a righteous person.
Do you have a system of ritual practices?
Definitely not. There is no system of ritual or religious practice that we suggest to anyone. We do make some suggestions about them feeling their feelings and emotions because we feel this is a very important part of having a relationship with God. We also make suggestions about praying, in other words, having a desire for God, a longing for God. We also make suggestions that people analyze themselves, that they look at themselves honestly and examine their own, concept of themselves to see whether it's actually loving or not, the things that they are doing, whether the things they are doing are loving or not. Their treatment of other people, we ask people to examine, whether they are treating other people in a loving manner, how they are treating their environment, we ask people to examine. But we don't have any practice to do it. We just present a whole series of information to people in just the same way as any other person on this planet presents a seminar. So someone like Wayne Dyer or Deepak Chopra even would go further than we do about presenting what I would classify to be rituals. Many of them believe in practicing meditation, for example. We don't even suggest that. So we don't suggest any practice, but we do suggest the need to develop desire to have a relationship with God, a relationship with your partner, a relationship based on love with God and your partner and others, and a relationship with your children, a relationship with your friends, a relationship with the environment. We suggest that we need to always examine these particular relationships and do whatever we can on a daily basis to improve them. But I don't feel that is like a religious practice or a regular practice that needs to be done. That is just something that is a daily occurrence. It is something that any person on this planet, if they are sincere in becoming more loving, they would have that kind of self-examination.
Cool.
They can also be a member of any religion and have that kind of self-examination. They can be a member of any political party and have that kind of self-examination. I believe that all of the things that Mary and myself are teaching can be incorporated into any organisation on the planet, religious or otherwise, and that organisation will improve in its ability to love other organisations and people. So that's what we suggest to people. Now, of course, many people go, well, that's pretty abnormal, because they believe that the only time you should love somebody is when they're your friend, or the only time you should love something is when, you know, you're getting something from it or whatever. But we feel you should always love some things. Even if the thing is attacking you, you need to love it. And we need to learn how to love all people in all interactions. That's what we teach. Now, many people, I suppose, may think that's abnormal, but I can't see why they'd be ever frightened of that kind of concept.
How would you define a cult?
I would, if it was me defining a cult, I would be looking at quite a number of areas. The first area would be its level of control over other people. I believe quite strongly that no one should have control over another person. And in fact, that God gave us free will and the ability to choose. So I feel a cult is any organization or individual who attempts to have control over another group of people or individual. So many times under that definition, families would turn into cults and religions would turn into cults. I feel, secondly, that any person who is desiring worship is automatically going to be a part of a cult. As I've stated earlier, or as I stated in other questions, God does not demand our worship. Therefore, any person who demands our worship or demands our honour is out of harmony with God, and therefore out of harmony with love. I feel that would be the second thing I would look at, whether people are demanding to be worshipped or demanding to be honoured. Aside from that, I would look at practices that demean or demonstrate a lack of love towards the individual. So any practice, I believe, that would attack an individual, demean them in some way, that is not honest, but is a desire to manipulate and control, that would also be something that a cult would do. Fourth, I believe that if there is such a thing as a cult, it would be a group of people who are willing to deceive other people. Now, under that condition, many organizations on this planet and individuals on this planet would come under that definition. I feel that any time we attempt to purposefully deceive another, we are automatically placing ourselves in a position where we are taking away the power of the other. What I believe needs to happen is we need to help people have the power to make their own choices and decisions, which is the opposite of taking away their power. We need to tell them the truth and then let them decide for themselves how they wish to act. If we withhold truth from people, then we are not telling them the truth, and we are deciding for them how they should act. And many people are not told the truth by governments, religions, and other organizations. And I feel that this is a way in which many organizations control individuals. This is completely out of harmony with love, and I feel cultish behavior. But I feel that those four things that I've mentioned are probably the main things that I would be looking at if I was looking at a person, you know, and asking myself the question as to whether they were a cult or not. Obviously, too, there's a fifth element, and that is this element of violence. If there is any element of violence or the potential for violence in the particular organisation that we're looking at, then I feel that that is also an element of cultish behaviour. If we look at that, even some governments have that in them. And so again, some governments would even come under that definition. If we truly love, we won't desire violence to be perpetrated towards another in any circumstance or situation. If we truly care about other people, we won't perpetrate violence ourselves. I believe that any organization that perpetrates violence towards any other individual or organization on the planet is automatically out of harmony with love. And in doing so, they are automatically placing themselves in a position of power or control over the other, over other people. And I believe that is what a cult would do. So those five particular things that I've mentioned, I believe, are the primary things that I would use to determine whether something is cultish or not in under today's definition of it. I do not believe, as I've previously stated, I do not believe the original meaning of the word, the Latin coming from the Latin, meant any of those particular things. However, the original meaning of the word did portray that God needs care, and I do not believe God needs care. God does not need us at all. God desires us, which is very different than needing us. And so I feel that whenever we use the word cult today, it's usually used in negative connotation. And if we were more intelligent about our assessment, we'd look at those five particular things that we that I've just listed and ask ourselves the questions. And any organization or individual that does not display those particular qualities would naturally not be a cult leader, even if he's accused of being one.
Are you a cult leader?
I am definitely not a cult leader. If a person looks at my answer to the question about what is a cult, my own definition of what is a cult, I certainly do not come under the definition of any of those particular things I've mentioned. A cult leader is a person who promotes control of other people, a person who's willing to manipulate other people into doing what he wants, who desires worship, and who desires control and power over others. I do not want any of those things. Just because I am saying that I am Jesus, it doesn't automatically make me a cult leader. What would make me a cult leader is whether I desired those particular things. And as the Bible record shows, and as my own record in this century shows, I have never desired those particular things. And so therefore, I cannot be defined as a cult leader in my opinion. But of course, that's just my opinion.
Do you require people to worship you?
Definitely not. I require that people do not worship me and that people worship God instead. That is what I require. In fact, if anyone attempts to worship me, I reject their desire to worship me and correct their desire to worship me by stating to them that I do not want their worship. I do not want their worship, and I do not need anything from them. All I desire to do is to teach any person who will listen about how to develop their relationship with God. I do not even believe that God needs our worship, but if we desire to worship someone, then my suggestion is to worship God, who is far greater than I, or and far greater than any person. My suggestion is to never worship another person, because if you worship another person, you are always at some point in the future going to be disappointed.
The public seem very fearful about cults. Why do you feel that that is?
Well, I feel that most of the public have been brought up in a cult, in the sense that most of the public have been brought up in the cult of family. If you examine almost every family, the behaviour generally is this. If any member of the family does not agree with the family, then generally they are expelled from the family or punished. Now, that is the actions of what I believe the actions of a cult would be. Now, because most people are brought up in that kind of environment where they're not really loved, but they are either punished or bartered with, I believe by the time they get to be adults, because those emotions have not been released from them, they are very sensitive to any organization that tries to do the same thing as what their parents did. Interestingly enough, though, they still accept their parents doing what they had generally done all of their lives, but they are very sensitive to other people doing that particular thing to them. Understandably so, I believe. We should not ever have to put up with that kind of behaviour where we are punished when we have a different point of view or opinion. And we should not ever have to put up the behaviour where we barter with people for their love. However, that is what most people are brought up with. And so that is what most people expect in a relationship. But they also become very sensitive to that kind of behaviour. As a result of their sensitivity to that kind of behaviour, they then become very focused in attacking individuals or groups of people who they believe, and they only have to believe it, it doesn't have to be true, but any person or group that has what they believe to be that behavior, they then become very attacking of, because in reality, they have not released their emotions they have with their own parents. They have not worked their way through the issues of why their parents did what they did. And they just take out these emotions on other people who are basically doing the same kind of thing as what they grew up with in their own family. That is why I believe the majority of people are afraid of cults. My opinion is there's very little to be afraid of, because you can leave anything if you have free will. You're allowed to leave anything at any time. You don't have to get involved. You can use your mind and you can use your emotional, clear emotional state to determine whether you want to be there or not. And you should never be anywhere where you do not want to be. So if somebody truly had any respect of themselves, they would not need to fear the potential of any cult. They would not need to attack it. I also believe another reason why people become afraid of cults is because many cults get established having different beliefs than the original person who's afraid of them. And the reason why the person is afraid is because they are often questioning of their own belief structure, and yet they are unable to do so in an open forum. So for example, if I'm of a certain type of religion, let's say I'm a Catholic, for example, and another religious group gets started up that directly contradicts my own belief system, there will be a great temptation within me to call that other religious group a cult. That way I can label the group and not have to examine their teachings to see how those teachings contradict my own and how my own teachings may be flawed. I feel a lot of people label other groups negatively because they are afraid of examining their own beliefs and afraid of examining their own emotions.
Wikipedia says, in the mass media and amongst average citizens, cult gained an increasingly negative connotation, becoming associated with things like kidnapping, brainwashing, psychological abuse, sexual abuse, and other criminal activity, and mass suicide. While most of these negative qualities usually have real documented precedents in the activities of a very small minority of new religious groups, mass culture often extends them to any religious group viewed as culturally deviant, however peaceful or law-abiding it may be.
Mm.
You've often been compared by the media to people who have encouraged violence, suicide, abuse, and criminal activity, such as David Koresh of the Branch Davidian movement.
Mm-hmm.
What do you say about these claims?
Well, firstly, as I've stated many times before, Mary and I are not setting up a new religious movement. We do not desire to set up a religion. We don't even desire to set up a group. All we desire to do is to visit people who desire to know more about their relationship with God and more truth from God's perspective. And we're willing to share that truth with anybody who asks. It doesn't matter what religion, what background, what political background, what cultural background, what country. We are completely open to discussing these particular matters with any individual. So we are not setting up a new religious group. All we are doing is sharing information that we believe is truth to other people who are willing to listen to it. That's all we are doing. In that regard, we are no different to any other person who does a similar thing. Some are like, you know, some of the popular world-renowned people who are seminar presenters. Myself and Mary are not world-renowned, but we are seminar presenters. We just present information to groups of people who desire to come along. We are different in that we don't charge for what we do. So people are allowed to come along for free and sit in the seminar for as long as they like and leave whenever they want. And they don't have to feel obliged to stay or obliged to leave or any other thing in between. So we have a very strong viewpoint that all we are doing is sharing information. However, what happens a lot is because I am saying that I am Jesus, most people then think that I'm now setting myself up above other people and that I want to be worshipped and all of these other things, which are not true. They say, they assume these things about me because that's what other people who have said they are Jesus have done in the past or are currently doing on the planet. I am very different to those people. But unfortunately, because I am saying that I'm Jesus, I am lumped in the same barrel as the other people, as the Wikipedia article suggested. There is only a small minority of groups of people on this planet that are truly dangerous when it comes to any new movement. And yet those ones tar the brush for any other person. Just because I am claiming that I am Jesus, it does not mean that I want to set up a religious movement. It does not mean that I want worship, and it does not mean that I want to be the leader of any particular movement. All I want to do, and all I have ever wanted to do, is share what I believe is the divine truth to people on the planet, which they themselves can discover for themselves, actually, through their own processes, and they don't need me to discover them. All I'm doing is sharing what I've discovered. That is all. I am not doing anything more than that. I don't have control over people. I don't manipulate people. I don't tell them what to do. I don't tell them how they should live their life. However, in their interaction with me, if they are not loving, I will walk away. That's the only limitation I place in any relationship with me, is that if you're going to be unloving towards me, then I probably am not going to enjoy a relationship with you. Now, I cannot see how that is comparable to these people that I'm often compared to. All this is a media beat-up attempting to make the association in people's minds between myself and these other people in order to have the media's viewpoint projected at the mass market. That's all it is. It's the media selling their own viewpoint using the fears of people they are selling it to in order to make a join between myself and these people who have been damaging and definitely been harmful to other people on the planet. I cannot agree with the behavior of these groups because they are unloving, just as I cannot agree with the behavior of the media because it's manipulative and controlling, power hungry, and therefore unloving. All I can do is continue to say what I'm actually doing, and that is I am presenting information in seminars for free if anybody wants to come along and listen. That's all I am doing.
It has been said by the media that you are the leader of one of the world's most chilling cults. What do you say to this?
Well, if talking about love and talking about truth and being a humble person makes you chilling, then I'm chilling. But I would have to question why a person believes that somebody who talks about love and truth and humility is chilling. Like, that in itself is chilling. Why would they believe such a thing? Like, I can't understand how people can label me as chilling when I'm one of the most, like, easy to get along with, loving persons they could ever meet. And I certainly don't try to harm anybody or damage anybody or do anything harmful to somebody. So why would they believe that I'm chilling? My suggestion is the only reason why the media has said such things, because only the media has ever said such things to me, is because they want ratings and they want people to go into their fear. And the way they manipulate ratings is to have people afraid so lots more people will watch what they're presenting. And the reality is many of these lie-based media reports about me, which I've commented about on our own website, I've listed many of the lies that the media has presented about us on our website for anybody to examine if they truly want to know the truth. These lie-based reports are all just a fabrication to manipulate people into believing something that will cause them to watch telly more so that the media outlets can get more advertising. It's a complete distortion of the truth and a manipulation of the truth in order to get more money out of people. And if I was the average person particularly in Australia, but any member of the public, I'd be questioning severely their underlying motive, because the reality is all I do is travel around the world at the invitation of others and share with them what I believe about love, truth, and humility. That's what I do. If that's chilling to you, then I would suggest that you've got some major fear-based issues that you need to work through.
People on internet forums have often said that anyone who listens to you is drinking the Kool-Aid, which means both blindly jumping on the bandwagon and being a team player, in reference to the Jonestown suicides. Mm-hmm. The media says that you are worse than Waco, referring to the USA government fight with the Branch Davidian movement. What do you say to these people?
I find these comments laughable, to be frank. These are comments that are made by people who obviously have some very severe fear issues within themselves and have no, it has no resemblance to the truth whatsoever. I am definitely not going to encourage anybody into a mass suicide. I disagree completely with suicide. I feel that while it's unfortunate that many people do on earth do suicide, I feel they have very severe emotional reasons for doing so, none of which I can agree with, suicide being the option. I feel instead it would be better if they worked through the particular emotions that are driving them to suicide. When it comes to drinking the Kool-Aid, in other words, everyone who listens to me is just sort of agreeing with me all the time, I cannot agree with that at all. If the average person comes along to a talk of mine, they will see that a fair majority of the people at different times do not agree with me at all. And I do not expect them to agree with me. However, I expect them to treat me in a respectful and loving manner while they're at one of my seminars that I've paid for the seat of. And so I'm certainly going to expect that they treat me in a manner that shows at least some respect. However, I don't expect them to believe me, worship me, follow what I say, do what I say. I am just sharing with them information about what I've learned. That is all. I certainly am not going to get any Kool-Aid, poison it, and then ask people to drink it. It's such a ludicrous extension to make these illogical assumptions. I feel that people are so illogical. Like, if they listen to 700 hours there is now of unedited material on YouTube about what I present, and if after listening to all that material, they actually assume that I'm going to at some point suggest a mass suicide, they are crazy, to be frank. Not me, they are crazy. Because it is something that has never crossed my mind. So I believe that people who have who say these things about me are just fear-mongering and being controlling and manipulative of other people who are afraid. If the average person came along to a seminar, they would feel very similar to any person who attends any seminar on any matter, let alone a religious one, if there is such a presentation of religious matters even in our seminars. So I feel quite strongly that these accusations are so far from the truth. They are manipulative, controlling, they are lies. And at some point in time, I would suggest to any person listening to it that they come along to a seminar and see for themselves, or they look at the 700 hours of YouTube seminars that are already there in context and see what is actually going on. I am just a guy presenting a heap of information to anybody who wants to listen. That's all I am.
Do you have a cult headquarters?
No. We don't have a cult, so we can't have a headquarters. Actually, it's interesting. That came from the original statement of that came from the Channel 7 crew, who actually stayed in our home. So they came here to this home, stayed in our home in both of our bedrooms. We let them have both of our bedrooms and we went down into a tent. And while they were staying in our home, they did all of this filming and all of this stuff going around, which later they called their hidden camera filming, which they come home to do. And then in their reports, they called it the cult headquarters. And since then, almost every media outlet has said, "Where's your cult headquarters?" And we've had people even come to visit us here who say to us, "Oh, is this your cult headquarters? Is this your headquarters?" And we go, "No, this is our home, for goodness sake. Like, what do you think is going on here?" So it all came about just because the Channel 7 film TV program wanted to portray us as a cult having some kind of headquarters and large amounts of money that we had disposable. This is a home myself and Mary, or I bought actually before I met Mary 7 or 8 years ago, before anybody gave me any donation whatsoever. I bought this home out of my own funds that I earned during business, and now it's being referred to as the cult headquarters that somebody else has donated to us. And I find that quite amusing.